Ellis up along the board. Picked up by Kuzinski. It's Darby Henriksen scores.
Minnesota Wild end of season special, a look back at season number two. Ryan Lund here with play-by-play voice of the Minnesota Wild, Mike Goldberg, and what a second season it was. And Mike, the best thing we can say, and as it should be, the team better in season two than season one.
And you know, Ryan, I think when things started out at the beginning of the year, many doubted that the Minnesota Wild would be a better hockey team than they were in year number one, because there were so many special moments and there were so many things that were motivating for year number one, having hockey back, teams taking the Wild lightly, if you will. And in the second season, that wasn't the case. And for the Wild to improve on their win total, to be the second most improved team in the entire National Hockey League, only the Blackhawks improved their point total more significantly from last season to this season, is a heck of a credit to the coaches and to the players.
And it's not necessarily rocket science why the Wild was able to improve from year one to year two. They wanted to score more goals. Yep. They did that. They wanted to improve on the power play. They did that. And that, of course, led to more points in the standings.
Oh, it certainly did. And the power play was a great bonus early. I mean, at Christmas time, the power play was ranked third in the National Hockey League. And the reason for that was the acquisition of Andrew Brunette. Andrew's actually going to be a guest on our show. We'll talk to him about the power play and about his leadership role that he had by the end of the season. But Brunette was able to move the puck around on the power play, the inverted power play, if you will. And so the Wild won a lot of games early. The Wild scored 25 more goals than they did one season ago. Sergei Joltok was a big reason for that. And Joltok also, Ryan, a big key contributor on the power play. And the thing about Brunette and Joltok, they helped to make the players around them better.
And what makes this improvement even better is that the Wild able to overcome a lot of injuries this season.
You know, it started in the preseason. It was disappointing when Cam Stewart got hit by Scott Ferguson of the Edmonton Oilers. And Cam Stewart may never play again because of post-concussion syndrome. And Cam was a big part of this hockey team. And then on opening night, Wes Walls hurts his ankle. Wes played 82 games last year. He and Antti Laaksonen, and Walls really wasn't right till midseason. And then the defensive corps got banged out. Brad Bombardier was out for an extended period of time. Philip Kuba. But the one thing the injuries provided was an opportunity for guys like Pascal Dupuis and guys like Richard Park and guys like Nick Schultz, who all had breakout seasons, if you will.
Well, certainly a lot to talk about season number two, and we are going to do just that. Andrew Brunette will join us, Jim Dowd. We will talk about the fans, that's you, and much, much more when we return to our Minnesota Wild special and take a look back at season number two.
Minnesota Wild Hockey is brought to you by XL Energy, proud to partner with the Minnesota Wild. By Wells Fargo, helping you meet your financial needs when, where, and how you choose. Wells Fargo, the next stage. By Bud Light, for the great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down. Make it a Bud Light. By Polaris, the official outdoor sports enthusiast vehicles of the Minnesota Wild. Polaris, the way out. And by Pontiac GMC, official vehicles for the Minnesota Wild.
All right, we're back with our Minnesota Wild special, taking a look back at season number two. And obviously a year ago, the Minnesota Wild, an expansion franchise, the first season in franchise history. Now in this second season, what we wanted to see was some improvement from year one to year two, and we did see that.
Not only individually, but collectively, this was a better hockey team. This hockey team got younger in year two, but yet they were as successful, and in the score column, more successful than they were in year number one, and many doubted that would be the case. I think what is most impressive about year two for the Minnesota Wild, are a couple of things. First of all, the Olympic schedule made it difficult for every team, but a younger team like Minnesota, it made it difficult for them with the travel and the condensed schedule, if you will. They also found themselves in a situation, Ryan, this year where teams did not take Minnesota lightly because it was so difficult to win games against Minnesota last year. They knew they could ill afford to have games get away from them this year. And so month by month, as the history continues for the Minnesota Wild, month by month, chronologically, we take you back at a successful season number two.
What a start for the Wild in season number two. Gavey DeRouche, shot, score! It might have been early October, but the Wild were already in mid-season form. They took it to the Kings in Los Angeles. Won the home opener against the Boston Bruins. And put a sixth spot on the board against the Blackhawks. All part of a six-game unbeaten streak to begin their sophomore season. November opened with the Wild, defeating the defending champions 4-2. And it closed with another beauty as Minnesota took it to Florida early and often. 6-0 was the final score. Score! 6-0 Wild! December brought some fortune for the squad away from the XL Energy Center. A handful of goals to beat the Penguins in Pittsburgh on the 14th. Then it was north of the border for a battle with Vancouver. And one-handed, he scores! What a pretty goal by Wes Walls! In what is becoming quite the rivalry, some gloves were dropped, and so were the Canucks. Final score, 2-1. No resolutions needed as the Wild began the new year with a 2-0 strike over the Lightning.
And out in front of Hendrickson, he scores!
Three other January wins, including a 4-2 victory over the Canadiens on the 8th, highlighted by this incredible goal by Wes Walls. A relatively light February due to the Olympic break, but still time for a couple of great showings. A Valentine's Day special, but Dwayne Roleson showed no love to Brad Isbister as he shut him down on a penalty shot to help beat the Islanders 4-3. And the month ended with another offensive explosion as five different goal scorers combined to beat the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim.
Bombardier a drive, and he scores!
March proved to be one of the most successful months in team history. Six victories and a winning record against many teams that were already fighting for playoff position. Stacey Roos' penalty shot boosted the beginning of the month. Marion Gabrick notched goals 20 and 21 in a shutout of the St. Louis Blues. Number 22 came in a 5-2 victory at Dallas. And two nights later, on the 10th of March, number 10 netted his second career hat trick as the Wild took it to the Jackets, shutting them out 5-0. March 26th, and a trip to St. Louis, provided the Wild with their third successful penalty shot of the season. He makes the move and scores! The second highest team total in NHL history. A few games in April capped off the wonderful season. The final victory coming on the 8th when the Wild took another bite out of the San Jose Sharks. Progress was definitely made in season number two. Five more points and one more victory for this young franchise. 10 players set new career highs for points in a single season. Andrew Brunette led the squad with 69 points, including 48 assists. Gabrick became the first 30-goal scorer in team history. Jimmy Dowd led all centers with 13 goals and 43 points, and a couple of young guns provided many highlights for today and hope for the future. Pascal Dupuis put 15 lamplighters on the board in his first full campaign, and 19-year-old Nick Schultz showed a lot of offensive prowess as he stepped in from the blue line on many timely occasions. All in all, a wonderful season number two for the Minnesota Wild.
It's great seeing a whole season's worth of highlights condensed into that one little package there. Now, you've seen every game this season, Mike. What's your personal favorite?
You know, my personal favorite is a goal that we did not show. It was an empty net goal, and it was an empty net goal that I thought Antti Laaksonen was going to score. And the story is well documented now. Late in the season, Antti Laaksonen had 14 goals. If he scores 15 goals, he earns a $25,000 bonus. The net is empty, and he passes the puck to Sergei Joltok. Joltok scored the goal. Laaksonen didn't make his bonus that night. Got it in the next game as it should be from the man upstairs. But it just showed how unselfish many of the players in this locker room are.
And we hear so much about the character of this team.
Yep.
I think that's a perfect example right there.
None better than that moment.
Well, speaking of characters, Jimmy Dowd is going to join us next and help us take a look back at season number two.
fans, it's time. So everybody, say it with Tony.
Let's play hockey.
All right, Tony O, getting us ready for the big game here on our Minnesota Wild special. I'll look back at season two, and we've got one of the guys to help us look back on season two, Mr. Jim Dowd, and a career best season for you, 43 points. That was your best. Why so good this year?
Probably because the guy sitting in the other room, Andrew Brunette. I mean, you saw some of the goals I got early in the year, and just playing with guys like that, him and Marion Gabrick for a while, and we had a good power play going for a while there, and, you know, racked up some decent numbers on it.
Jimmy, last year you had played 68 games, the year prior 69 in Edmonton, and I know at the end of the season I tried to tease you a little bit about the fact you're on pace to play every game this year, and you said, hey, don't say anything about it, don't jinx me, but as an NHL player, to say that there will be a season, at least one, that you played all 82 games, that has to be a great sense of pride for you.
Oh, definitely. I mean, you know, you want to play in every game. And early in my career, getting sat out a few times here and there. And then when I did become a regular, you know, last year, for most of the time, I got hurt there in January, missed a month. So it was, you know, a good accomplishment, if you want to look at it like that. Coming back this year, playing all 82 games, it's a good feeling.
When you put the point totals together, playing in every game, do you feel like, yeah, this was by far my best season in the NHL?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, it was a good year, definitely one of my best, obviously, playing the most games and getting the most points, if you want to look at it like that. And it was a pretty satisfying year for that. You know, that extent, but I just want to look for bigger and better things next year.
Not only from yourself, Jimmy, but from those of us who know you well and have the opportunity to work with you every day, you want to see bigger and better things from this entire organization and from this hockey team.
Oh, definitely. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, we were just talking about it, you know, since the season ended. It didn't feel like that was the last game of the year, the Edmonton game. You know, we feel like as a group we have so much more to give. And, you know, guys are just going to go home and work hard and get ready for training camp next year. And a bunch of guys on this team, if not everybody, can't wait for that to happen.
The organization always maintains that it's going to stay the course and slow progress every year. Is it tough for you as a player sometimes? Do you wish that maybe we're going to speed things up here and make a run at the playoffs?
Well, that comes down to the guys in the locker room. You know, the guys in there have to say, hey, wait a minute. You know we can win now, and that's what we want to do. I've talked about it with a few guys on the team. I mean, Andrew Burnett's one of those guys. You know, Wes Wall, Darby Hendrickson. I mean, a bunch of guys are on the team. That Brad Bombardier, we want to win now. We know we can. We got a taste of it this year. You know, we did better than we did last year. And if you look at the ups and downs we had this year, if we can just minimize those next year, you know, we'll be fine.
It was a drought, obviously, with the two wins in 15 games. It was the difficulties that this hockey team had to win in overtime. But still, 93 points to get into the playoffs, 95 points in the Western Conference. Jimmy, that's a lot of points, and that means this hockey team does have a lot of improving to do. You can't let any point get away, can you?
No, I mean, that's a definite right there. Like we said, there were plenty of games in that 2 out of 15 stretch or whatever it was that we were right on top. We were playing great for two periods, and for some reason this year we struggled in the third period, whereas in the first year, last year, you know, we had great third periods. We shut teams down.
But it's one of those things we got over with as the year went on. It was just too little, too late. And next year, if we can just do that right off the bat and, you know, work on that overtime record there,
get a few more wins and a couple less losses, and, you know, that should put us into the playoffs or get us, you know, closer.
All right, Jim, well, congratulations on a career-best year for you and a great year on the ice. When we come back, we will talk about what took place off the ice with the Minnesota Wild as we take a look back at year number two.
It's great to be here, and I'd just like to say we've never dropped a puck in public before. Everybody ready? Let's play hockey!
The new Slim and Trim, John Popper, and members of Blues Traveler, getting you ready for one of the many games at the X here this season. And Mike, you were there for every game and for many of the practices with the team. We've seen a lot of the moments on the ice, some of the milestones, but
team also keep him very busy off the ice as well.
You know, and I think to a man, if you asked anyone in the department, the community relations department of the Minnesota Wild, they would say yes is the answer that comes out of the player's mouth 95% of the time when they're asked to do something other than just play hockey. And we talked earlier, Ryan, about the Olympic schedule and how demanding it was just for the guys to be ready to be a hockey player, to play in the National Hockey League and have this team competitive. They're asked to do many things. They always say yes. They're visible in the community, and they're not afraid to give back.
Many pro athletes with so many demands on their time, and the Minnesota Wild, no exception.
Yeah.
But the way they handle it is exceptional. Let's just take a little bit of a look at what the Wild do.
When the Minnesota Wild took the ice last season, their first mission was to reestablish the tradition of hockey in Minnesota. That kept the team busy on the ice. It was their second mission that kept them active off it. Reaching out to the community in many ways, the Wild players, coaches, and front office kept a very busy schedule.
Welcome everyone to this room, and we're proud to be a part of the hospital. Welcome.
While the 2001 season was winding down, the team didn't slow down in its work in the community. In late March, a new teen room was dedicated at Children's Hospital in St. Paul, thanks to the Wild's 10,000 Rinks Foundation. Today's youth face many challenges. Battling an illness only makes life more difficult. But these young people can now have their cake and eat it too, with a place to call their own at Children's Hospital.
And the teen room at Children's Hospital, just one of the many examples of some of the work that the Minnesota Wild and the players have accomplished here in the community this season, last season, and of course coming up here in the future. Matt Maka, the Vice President of marketing for the Minnesota Wild, joins us now. Matt, what are some of the other examples that the 10,000 Rinks Foundation has accomplished here in the community?
There's been a lot, actually. The 10,000 Rinks Foundation was formed to really help to grow the sport of hockey, I guess, primarily, and that has happened in a number of ways with a number of our partners, including Minnesota Hockey, which is the amateur governing body of hockey in the state of Minnesota, and then, of course, Minnesota Amateur Sports Commission and the Coaches Association. We work closely with the State High School League, bringing the tournament to the XL Energy Center. And so there's a lot of hockey-oriented growth and efforts on our part. And then, of course, you saw that the Children's Hospital partnership, which has been a wonderful outlet for our players and our organization to help people who are struggling in various ways.
You know, Matt, there are so many areas in which the Wild would like to get involved. And a compliment to the organization is that you do get involved in most of those areas, because there are many great charities throughout the Upper Midwest. But the Children's Hospital partnership and the opening of that teen room, how special was that to the organization the day it happened, to know that so much thought and so much effort went into that, and that those young people were going to get so much out of it in the future?
Yeah, it was a really special project because it allowed our staff and our players, as well as people at Children's Hospital, to not only design and conceive the room and then to open it up that day. We had a great crowd there that day. Many kids showed up, and along with our players, as you saw in the footage there. And so it's just been an outstanding project and a great way for the Wild to become involved and to brighten the day of a young child at Children's Hospital.
The community work, just part of your responsibilities as Vice President of Marketing. Obviously, the other part is marketing. And the State of Hockey campaign seems to have been just a great success here. We're now in the second year of it. Tell us a little bit about it.
Well, it's funny. You all know that Minnesota has a great tradition and a great pride when it comes to hockey. And I often say, only half jokingly, that the most important part of our job in marketing is to stay out of the way. Mm-hmm. You know, there's just such a wonderful sort of tradition in place, and it was, you know, was lived out again this year with another great state high school hockey tournament, and of course the Gophers national championship, and another great Wild season. So we really do respect our fans' knowledge for and love of the game, and we really do try to stay out of the way and allow for the natural relationship to occur between Minnesota hockey fans and all the great teams that play hockey in Minnesota.
Now, it was a special year for the Wild and the organization, and you played great host for the Gophers. Let's see if we can get that thing back in St. Paul again. Maybe the Gophers will win another title. Matt, thank you.
Sounds great. Thank you.
And with 87 consecutive sellouts, I'd say that marketing campaign is pretty effective.
That's why he's still here.
That's right. Matt, thank you. Congratulations. We will be back with more of our Minnesota Wild special as we continue to take a look back at season number two.
Hockey fans, it's time to drop the puck. So let's everybody say it with me. Let's play hockey!
I'll do whatever he says.
Yeah. Former Viking Jim Marshall, if he tells you to say let's play hockey, exactly. Then we're going to play hockey. Well, we're back in our Minnesota Wild special, a look at the second season, and it may be the second season, but we still had some firsts this year.
Yeah, and it was a nice year for a lot of players to have an opportunity to earn their living every day in the National Hockey League. And Ryan, we talked about this in year one last year, that guys came in having part-time roles in the NHL, or guys came into the Wild organization yet to be established in the NHL on a full-time basis, because they either played on the third or fourth line, or they played in the minors. And so to come into the Minnesota organization was an opportunity for many.
Great opportunity, and many of those guys taking advantage of it, and for them it feels like the first time.
Now back at the right point, rolls it off the board, back to Burnett, back behind the goal. Center is passed back in front, they score! Nick Schultz, his first National Hockey League goal!
Shaw in, tip goal, save!
Turned it over, Gabbert chased it down. Stewart knew Blouin was coming.
Blouin in front, he scores! Sylvain Blouin has scored! Up the side of the net from the stick of Sekeres. Again, he bangs at it, they score! Power play goal for Minnesota. It's 1-0 Wild. Lubomir Sekeres with the power play goal.
Burrett over the line with Bob Sweeney.
Comes across the line, leads to Donald Kelly. Here is Berta, first NHL goal! Tony Berta, and a pretty one at that. To the point of Kubas. Kubas across to Sekeres. Sekeres in front, shot, score! There it is! The first ever goal in the National Hockey League for Pascal Dupuis. Gets it back to Stacey Roos. Roos to Benesik. Quick drive, score! A power play goal for Ladislav Benesik. It is 1-0 Minnesota.
His first career NHL goal, and he's happy about it. Well, it looks as if those career first goals, if they didn't come in a Wild uniform, they came in a Bruins uniform.
Hey, this guy over here scored his first NHL goal in a Washington Capitals uniform, and now a captain here in Minnesota. How was your first year as a member of the Wild?
It was a blast. I mean, I had, right from the start, didn't know what to really expect, and you know, it's been great. I mean, I really enjoyed the city of Minnesota, and Twin Cities, I guess. I really enjoyed playing hockey here, and it's nice to come to the rink, and the fans appreciate, you know, what you do for a living, and you know, they've been great all year. It's been a real fun year.
When you came here in the off season, did you ever anticipate that at the end of the year you'd have the most points on the roster?
No, I don't think so. I don't think you ever go into your thinking that you with goals. I don't think you send them for points. I just wanted to come in and play good hockey, play the way that I know how to play. You know, bring what I think my strengths are to the team, and kind of whatever happens, happens.
Well, the ultimate compliment given to you, Andrew, is one given to you by a couple of your line mates. Of course, Marian Gaborik with the 30 goals this year. Jimmy Dowd was on the show earlier. He said, you know what, why were my points so much more than in years past? Asked Andrew Brunette. So that has to be the ultimate compliment when your line mates compliment you on making them better players.
Yeah, I mean, that's real, I'm flattered to hear that. But, you know, I think for a line to work good together, I think everybody has to be a little bit unselfish and give up a little bit of themselves. And I think, you know, Marian and Jimmy did that, you know, throughout the course of the year when we were successful together. And, you know, we really clicked and we had a lot of fun playing together. And, you know, hopefully next year we'll get that opportunity again.
Another compliment for you. This is turning into the Andrew Brunette love. But, Wild GM Doug Risebrough said, we knew that we were getting a great score when they got you in the offseason, but they didn't know about your leadership value. How does that make you feel?
Yeah, you know, I just look at that as I'm just trying to be myself. And you know, I think I've been fortunate enough to play with a lot of guys that, you know, are great leaders, and I take a little bit off them every time. And guys in this room that are good leaders and things that I believe they do right, I try to, you know, incorporate them. And I was lucky enough to, you know, been able to wear the C. I mean, you know, a lot of guys throughout the course of the year wore it. I think six guys or five guys. And I was, you know, very fortunate. Every kid grows up from who, you want to be a captain of an NHL team. And they gave me that opportunity. And like I said, I just went with it and tried to be myself.
As humble as you obviously are about it, Andrew, and that's one of the reasons why you're a strong leader, it seems once that C was put on your sweater, though, you were mentally prepared to be a captain. You kind of knew what you wanted to do and maybe some things you wanted to work on within the room.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, everybody, I think if you ask anybody that, I think everybody sees things differently. You know, I thought, you know, if I was going to wear the captain, there's a few things that I wanted to address or what I wanted to do a certain way, and, you know, I try to incorporate them, but... You know, our room, we're lucky. We have, you know, we have a lot of leaders in the room, and I basically you just try to get their input and do what's right for the team.
What do you got planned for the off season?
I'm going to stick around here for a while. I haven't really got to enjoy the city of Minnesota that much, and, you know, we've been so busy this year, so I'm hoping to get out and see things, maybe play a little bit of golf, and then I got to head out back home to Sudbury, Ontario, where I have a house, and kind of kick back, relax, and visit, and get ready for next season.
All right, Andrew, well, congratulations. Thank you for joining us. 69 points for Andrew Brunette this year, 48 assists, which was ninth in the NHL. Not bad. Andrew Brunette, one of the fan favorites. And we are going to hear from those Minnesota Wild fans when we return for our Minnesota Wild special, a look back at season number two.
Makes me jam.
And it's time to drop the puck.
So everybody, boys and girls of all ages, say it with us. Let's play hockey!
Now, we have had some great Let's Play Hockey pregame announcements, but I don't know if you can top the Hanson.
I'll tell you what, I was fired up. Just when they came in, I was like a little kid. I just needed an autograph or a picture or something. It was awesome. I mean, the atmosphere that the XL Energy Center presents for the fans is... And I have the blessing of traveling around the NHL is as good as any in the National Hockey League. And I think everyone in the state of hockey in the state of Minnesota, Ryan, knew it would be good, but didn't realize how good it could be. And it has surpassed all expectations. But the one thing about the fans, and I remember my first game ever, it was right here on Channel 9. I spoke to Al Shaver. He was in the booth with us that night. And, of course, the Hall of Fame broadcaster that he is. I said, tell a young play-by-play guy who knows he will never fill your shoes because they have been bronzed. But what should I do to have success in this market? And he said, never lie to the fans. They love the game, they know the game, and it is their passion.
Well, you certainly don't want to lie to the fans at XL Energy Center because every day there are over 18,000 of them. Let's take a look.
at a Wild game this season, sitting among 18,465 fellow Wild fans, you may have been too busy watching the game
to realize
that you're a part of an NHL record.
You know, when the game's on the line and it's a close game, and you can really feel the crowd, especially here. I mean, the crowd kind of carrying a little bit. And you know, when they get excited, it seems that when you're the home team, you seem to get excited. And
the home crowd makes this season another one for the books. No empty seats at XL Energy Center again. In fact, every NHL game at the arena has been a sellout, 87 in a row, including 5 preseason games. What happens in the stands is as important as what happens on the ice.
The excitement that the Wild fans have brought here has been unbelievable. Personally, being from Minnesota, it's been a thrill for myself. It's an honor to play in your hometown. A lot of guys don't get that experience.
As the season ends, the tradition continues. Wild players thank Wild fans with the shirts off their backs.
Wow, great crowd against the Stars, record-setting, 19,042 back around Thanksgiving last year. And if you want to be part of the action in the future, season ticket information given to you at 651-222-WILD. A $100 deposit reserves your spot in the Minnesota Wild Warming House. Now, that doesn't mean you have to get the season tickets this year. You can get them when it is financially time for you to do so. It's a great opportunity to get inside that building. It's the best in the league.
Exactly. Wild tickets tough to come by, so you want to get yourself on that list. Get yourself
That's why I have
priority.
A media credential.
Exactly. Well, we've heard about the fans. We've heard from some of the players. How about the coach? Jacques Lemaire is next.
Say it with us. Let's play hockey!
Just one more reason you never want to miss a Wild hockey game, because that night I wasn't there. You had the Ben and Jerry's in the press box.
And some Ben and Jerry's left over at home. I got a few gallons of Oreo cookie and cream at the house. Just stop by. I'll fix you up.
I appreciate that.
You're
welcome. Thank you very much. Well, from ice cream to ice hockey.
Come on now.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
I've been practicing.
No teleprompter, no. Wow.
No,
you're amazing.
This is all right off the cuff. Nobody knows more about ice hockey than Jacques Lemaire. How do you think he feels about what he saw from the Wild this season?
I know when it's all said and done, Jacques is extremely pleased with what he saw the ice product develop into in year number two. Basically, Jacques issued a challenge to every member of the Minnesota Wild organization, players especially, the beginning of the year. Be better than you were before. Get on the ride, because the ride is an upward spiral and you must stay with us and play well. And no one proved more to Lemaire this second season than the captain, Andrew Brunette.
Andrew is a great addition for our team. This year he's been involved in nearly every play that contribute to a goal. He's a guy that sees the ice very well, a guy that knows where everybody is on the ice, knows the game very well. You can rely on him, even in the defensive zone. Having him is a big part of our success on the power play. He's the guy that takes charge and will start plays or will finish plays. Andrew Brunette can do that. There's no doubt that Andrew helped a lot to Marianne's success. Marianne is a goal scorer. He's good to move the puck also. He's great skating. And the combination, the two, they gel well together. They know each other on the ice. And, both guys have success, and it's because of who they play with, too. There's no doubt we were looking for more offense. Our first year, we felt that it was kind of hard to get some goals. And with Brunette and Zoltuk, these guys are, more offense-minded than other guys. And, it's great for us, because now we can win games with three or four goals. The crowd's been really great for us, and you can tell when a game starts, you know, the fans are really lively, and you can tell by looking at the other team, you know, I'm sure they don't have that in their building, and they see the excitement, and, you know, it gets you in easier. It gets you to play hard and you know, try to do your best for these fans.
And Jacques has really learned to love the fans in the state of hockey, the state of Minnesota, and he would know about loyal fans and educated fans playing all those years in Montreal, growing up in Montreal, where the fans can be difficult to play in front of, but they are a loving bunch of fans when you are successful. So Jacques basically saying, merci beaucoup to the fan support here in St. Paul.
I think he also said
thank you. I think he did.
Hey, that's a good point.
Yeah.
You're bilingual. Not only that, you speak two languages.
Well, Jacques Lemaire's second season in Minnesota is finished, but we're not finished. Mike and I coming back to wrap up our Wild season special.
Hockey is brought to you by Polaris, the official outdoor sports enthusiast vehicles of the Minnesota Wild. Polaris, the way out. By CCM, when you're born to play. By Wells Fargo, helping you meet your financial needs when, where, and how you choose. Wells Fargo, the next stage. By Pontiac GMC, official vehicles for the Minnesota Wild. And by XL Energy, proud to partner with the Minnesota Wild.
Well, it's time to finish our end-of-the-season special. We've taken a look back at season number two, and you can't help but get a little bit excited when you look ahead to season number three.
Well, I know the organization, Ryan, is extremely excited of the challenges that lie ahead, and they are monumental challenges, because when you consider in the Western Conference this hockey season, it took well over 90 points in the standings to earn a berth in the playoffs. It means the Wild are going to have their hands full in trying to become a playoff team. First step will be to become a playoff contender, and with the nucleus they already have, plus the draft picks waiting in the wings, Mikko Koivu, we might see him next year, probably not for a year after that, and the eighth pick in the draft this season, things will get better, this team will continue to improve, and when they get there, and that is to the playoffs, they want to stay there, and that has always been Doug Risebrough's main objective when you speak of the long-term growth of this hockey team.
Long-term growth, definitely the goal, and the Wild on path for that right now. Mike, it's been fun.
Thank you, buddy.
All righty. We'll do it again next year, and we'll have many more exciting moments to talk about. For Mike Goldberg, Ryan Lund, our season special is finished, but it's only appropriate that in Minnesota, a special about hockey, that the Baja men take us out.